Let the trumpets play and the angels sing every sweet refrain of amazing grace, and that heaven's hands opened up the gate and the children danced when they saw your face. As happy as they were to see you coming, I was just as sad to have to watch you go. Oh, but knowing what I know about heaven, believing that you're all the way home, knowing that you're somewhere better is all I need to let you go. I could hope that I could pray you back, but why on earth would I do that when you're somewhere life and love never ends? Oh, knowing what I know about heaven, where every single voice makes a joyful noise. How sweet the sound when the saints rejoice. To every broken heart and every wounded soul, new life begins on streets of gold. With every tear that's raining here from my eyes, I know the sun is shining where you are. Oh, knowing what I know about heaven, believing that you're all the way home, knowing that you're somewhere better is all I need to let you go. I could hope that you're somewhere life and love never ends. Oh, knowing what I know about heaven, I could hope that I could pray. Jesus wants to love you. There is none above you. You are precious in His sight. He will never fail you. When the doubts assail you, He'll be with you.
Amen.
His love
is a boundless love,
and it reaches down and touches me.
Brother.
Congregation, please rise. You may be seated. Good afternoon. Thank you for being here today to celebrate the life of Albert Sawatzky and to mourn his passing together with his family. My name is Jeff Bandman. I'm the pastor here at Cornerstone, and we were privileged to count Albert as part of our church family here the past number of years, and it's my honor to lead this service today and to walk with this family as they lay to rest a father, a grandfather, and a great-grandfather. The last time I visited with Albert, we sat in his living room and chatted for a long while. And at one point, he turned to me and said, "My bags are all packed up." I was pretty certain I knew what he meant, but just to be sure, I asked him. I said, "What do you mean by that, Albert?" He said, "I'm ready to go meet my Lord and Savior and all those who have gone before me." He was ready to meet Jesus. And for Albert's part, that meeting could have come much sooner, and he was ready and waiting for a good while. But the Lord knew the right timing, and that timing was 8 days ago with his son Mike by his side. As we talked about heaven, Albert shared how he was looking forward to the music in heaven. Those who knew Albert well knew that he had a love for music. And we will sing and hear some of Albert's favorite songs in this service. He shared with me how his voice had been damaged, that he couldn't sing like he used to. And he looked forward to singing in heaven with a full voice. Today, Albert is no longer struggling for breath. I can only assume he sings like an angel in the presence of his Lord and Savior. And for that, we rejoice with Albert. He has gone on to his great reward. And we will do our best to join him in singing this morning. But for those of us who remain on this side of heaven, we will miss Albert, your dad, your grandpa, our friend. And so while we are glad for Albert, today is also a day of sorrow and sadness. God never promises that if we follow him, there will not be hard days. And this is certainly one of them. But he does promise to walk with us on the journey. So I'll read as an invocation some lines from Isaiah 43. These are words of comfort from God to his people when they are facing difficult roads. And after that, we'll turn to God in prayer. So the words of Isaiah: "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior, since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you." Let us pray. Father, you tell us not to fear, because you have called us by name and because you love us. You have promised that even though we will walk through rivers, we'll not be carried away. And though we walk through fire, we'll not be burned. And so we ask, Father, that you would help this family and all the rest of us to walk through this service and to walk through the coming days ahead. Lord, we rejoice for your servant Albert, that he is in your steady and sure hands. And for that we are glad. But we need your steady hands as well. And so would you carry us, as you always do, down the difficult paths of life and through this service today. Amen. Just a couple of announcements as we continue on. Immediately following the service, there will be a lunch provided in the gym, and we'd invite you all to stay for that. If you want to join the family for the interment immediately following, you're welcome to do that as well. It will just be down the road in Pilot Mound. We'll make those announcements again at the end of the service, but if you'd like to join, you're certainly welcome. So at this time, we're going to turn to lifting our voices to sing in songs of praise of God.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears believed. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Thank you. At this time, I'm going to invite David Hyde up. David was a close friend of Albert, and he's going to do the scripture reading and the reading of the obituary. And immediately following that, we'll invite the family who's going to come and share some of the tributes. So I'll invite you, David, to come.
Good afternoon. My name is David Hyde. I'm a friend of the family and a distant relative on Mary's side, and it is an honor to be here this morning with you all. I wish you, his family, could take a look at who's all showed up today, and it's wonderful. I've been asked to read the scripture passage from Psalm 23, but I've been given an open window to just make a few comments this afternoon. May I first offer my condolences to you, Mike and Tanis, to you, Janet, and to all of your family here today. You have been faithful to standing with your father, your grandfather, and your great-grandfather. For that, I commend you. In many conversations with your dad, he was so proud of you, Michael. You were his one and only favorite son. And Janet, you were by far his favorite daughter. Yeah. In brief, I'd like to share what a pleasure it's been to get to know and visit with your dad. I didn't know him quite as long as maybe many of you here today. I didn't think I'd do this. But these last years have been really special. Connecting with Albert over a cup of coffee. And I've got one here, and it was special. And I know many others could relate with that as well. Richard, you spent a lot of time with Albert, and others for sure. When one called Albert, "Does it work to come for coffee?" there was this predicted answer, "Sure!" Usually that happened once, maybe every second week. We'd engage in everything from politics to religion, to sports, to motorcycles, to family history and getting to know our past family connections. Of course, farming and farm machinery had to come into play. It was fun to talk to him and tell him about those Case IH equipment and, well, I just said they were just junk. Well, he gave a strange, quiet look and he'd go, "What?" And then some off-the-road comment would happen talking about the green stuff. We won't mention that name. Often he would ask some pretty heavy theological questions too. And I didn't mind deferring to Richard Clausen and put him under pressure to maybe answer some of those questions. But as some of you that visited with Albert can attest to, he missed his wife Mary so much. She definitely was the love of his life and talked about her so often. One thing I gotta say is this, that in most of the visits with Albert, you always felt better than when you first got there. Despite your dad's increasing challenge since requiring oxygen, he handled it to the best of his abilities and sure didn't complain much. He was a real trooper and truly an inspiration as he fought the good fight. Visiting with him a few days before he passed away, you could see his struggle for breathing was taking its toll. We'd sit and we'd watch some television together. Albert enjoyed tennis. As we sat and watched a major tournament from Indian Wells, California, he so often expressed a desire that he would love to have been there firsthand. And I would love to have granted him that privilege, but we knew that just wasn't going to happen. Although it didn't come as a surprise, it was still hard to see that Friday morning that our dear friend, coffee buddy, had gone to be with the Lord. Even now, when one drives by, I still want to stop and have one more cup together with him. Thanks for the coffee, Albert. My joy comes, and I hope for you as a family as well, in knowing that his struggle is truly over. He is experiencing the joy of the Lord and all that heaven can offer. I can only imagine his dear wife, Mary, standing there with arms wide open. The old hymn, "Breathe on me, breath of God," I would say truly brings to life a new change for your dad as he is relieved of his struggle forever. Albert wasn't maybe an avid reader in his last years, but in discussions with Pastor Jeff, I know this is an all too familiar psalm, but he had Psalm 23 marked in his Bible. It truly stands out as being just as important if you've heard it for the 100th time as if you've heard it now for the very first time. And I'd like to read that to you right now. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And it comforted Albert. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I, Albert, will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. I'd like to read the obituary that the family has put together for Albert Sawatzky. It is with deep sorrow and much love that we mourn the passing of Albert John Sawatzky. He entered his heavenly home suddenly in his home in Pilot Mound on March 15, 2024, at the age of 76. Albert is survived by his four siblings and his son Mike and Tanis, daughter Janet, grandchildren Kyle and Amy, Cole and Nancy, Bradley and Hunter, Shana and Austin, and great-grandchildren Sadie and Hannah. He was predeceased in death by his parents Abe and Anna Sawatzky, brother Herman, nephew Cameron, and two brothers-in-law, John and Henry. Albert was born on February 5th, 1948 in Winkler. He went to school in Plum Hollow, Killarney, and Winkler Bible College. Albert's love for choir, music, and socializing led him to meet the love of his life, Mary Hyde. They got married in 1970 and welcomed Michael in 1971 and Janet in 1974. Albert was a successful salesman who had passion for people, his family, and good farm equipment. He enjoyed welding, horses, motorcycling, and camping with family and friends. Albert was known for his wit, humor, and one-liners. He touched the lives of many and will be deeply missed. Here's to you, Albert.
Sorry, folks, I'm not as tall as everybody else. One of the lines of those songs that was sung says it well. I believe in a man called Jesus, and I believe that he died for me. My name is John Dirksen. I'm Janet's uncle. You can come closer to me. And my connection is through my wife, Sarah, who is Mary's sister, and honored to be up here with Janet and Shana. Now, they were going to try to do this, but then they decided that they weren't going to, and I was going to read their tributes. So, obviously, if the expressions don't come the same, you'll know why, right? Because I'm not them. But as I've read what they wrote, it becomes very evident who they are and who Albert was to them. So I'm going to start with Shana's. I'm going to get you to hold that for me. Good, thank you. Shana says this, Grandpa. You taught us how to love in so many ways. Your and Grandma's love was remarkable and one of a kind. Your partnership was Christ-centered and steadfast in faith, patience, and genuine care for one another. You had a passion for so many things. You were the most charismatic, funny, and humble people. You lit up every single room you came into and put a smile on the faces of so many. The love of God shined through you, right through you. You faced many problems and trials, yet your faith and your wit never fell short. Many of us have experienced that. You never complained, and your jokes and fast, witty comments will surely be missed. You enjoyed the most simple things in life. And then she just talks about her thoughts. My grandpa was a godly man and a family man. It was very easy for him to make a friend wherever he went. He wasn't just a grandpa to me, but a father figure who is nothing short of my hero and simply my best friend and favorite person. My grandpa knew this too. My friends became his friends, and he cared about everything that his loved ones cared about. Needless to say, Grandpa built a bigger table, not a taller fence. And Grandpa's last hospital stay, I asked him what he wanted to do for work when he was younger, and if he would have done anything different. As a young person myself, who just started my career, I wondered if he had any regrets or dreams that he didn't follow through on. He said that from day one, he wanted to be a salesman. This aspiration came from a mentor he had in his first working careers whom he admired so much. Becoming a salesman is exactly what my grandpa did and loved. He had a passion for people and, again, good farm equipment that allowed him to be successful in this field. He loved meeting new people and connecting with old friends and colleagues. His strong work ethic paved the way for our family. My grandpa ingrained in all of us that we should never choose a career for the money, but to choose a career that would make us feel like we've never worked a day in our lives. This is what he did. My grandpa embodied Christ in so many ways. I can only imagine what it was like when you entered heaven on March 15th and Christ told you that you were his good and faithful servant. At last you are with your one true love, Grandma. I can't imagine how incredible this reunion must have been. Grandpa, thank you for sharing your love of God with our family, demonstrating what it means to wholeheartedly love your partner and family, and for simply being the best. You set the bar real high, and we will miss you. And this is for Janet, as she writes to and about her dad. Dad, my precious Papa Bear, you were and will always be my hero and best friend. I miss you so much already. Of all the special gifts in life, great or small, to have you as my dad was the greatest gift of all. You were the best teacher, mentor, and so passionate about everything you did. I will always admire your strength, humbleness, and love you had for your family, friends, and career. You truly never did work a day in your life. The countless memories of our shared passions for horses, motorcycles, gospel singing, dancing, and might I add, eating out. Most of all, our endless laughter. I will cherish these memories forever. Although I cannot see you, feel your loving hugs, or kiss your face, I'll imagine you're beside me, an unseen presence I will always embrace. The night before you left us, asleep, no words were spoken. A gentle kiss placed on your head, Heaven's gates stood halfway open. Reflections of that morning, before dawn you slipped away, still replay through my daily thoughts. I will never forget that day. Cannot begin to tell you just what that has meant to me, the painful process of letting you go, the day I so dreaded the hole in our family. I miss your hugest hugs, your voice, your laughter, your genuine I love you, and you the best. You the best. The simple spring lost in your step, the illness got that too, but you never complained. You just chose to count your amazing blessings. I will not try to wallow too much in sorrow. You wouldn't have wanted it that for me. Your wish to remain the strong one is the one you want it to be. And though I knew each day will be difficult, that I will still want to call on you, Dad. Your swift, untimely departure will always make me reflect on just how blessed to have the absolute best dad ever. Now that you are in your heavenly home, you long to go to, it melts my heart to know you are with our precious mom again, who loved you so much and adored. I just have to say it one more time, Dad. Bless your precious heart for everything. I can't wait to see you again. I love you more than words could ever express. Love, your baby girl. Thank you, and God bless you, ladies.
If I'd surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I could count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal ken, and I'm sure that He'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. Places of beauty we've longed to see here below, but times and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew, and then we'll stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven.
stroll over heaven with you.
Thank you, David, for those kind words about your friend. Thank you, Janet and Shayna, for your words that I'm sure express the sentiments of your whole family. As we heard in the scripture reading earlier, Psalm 23 was a favorite of Albert's, and I thought it would be a good starting point to offer some reflections on Albert's life and some thoughts on the God who holds all of our lives in his hands. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters, and he restores my soul. He guides me along paths of righteousness for his name's sake. The beginning of Psalm 23, one of the most well-known passages of Scripture, focuses our attention on a God who is good. God is pictured as a good shepherd who takes good care of his sheep, bringing them to green pastures and to quiet waters. When times are hard, we need to be reminded that God is good. We sometimes come up with ideas in our heads of what God is like, based on what we hear from others or how we make sense of the events of our life. If what we come up with as we imagine God is anything less than a good shepherd, we are not seeing God as he truly is. I believe Albert knew God as he truly is, especially in his later years. He understood God as a good shepherd, who had at many times in his life brought Albert to green pastures and to quiet waters. Albert knew the goodness of God, which is why he loved to sing songs in praise of who God is. Albert had shared with me how his 76 years had been a series of ups and downs in his walk with God. There were many times where it felt like green pastures and quiet waters, and being close to God came easily and naturally. But Albert also shared that there were deserts to walk through as well, difficult parts of the journey. And it is precisely those difficult parts of the journey where having the good shepherd at your side makes all the difference. This leads us to the next lines of Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. This psalm written by David acknowledges that even if we give ourselves to God, even if we trust ourselves completely to the Good Shepherd, we will still walk down difficult roads and even through the valley of the shadow of death. Sometimes we walk in green pastures and beside quiet waters, but sometimes it's a desert, a walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And we try at all costs to avoid this valley. We try to stay high on the mountains, as it were. We would like to travel from peak to peak if possible and try not to look down at that dark valley below. For the most part, we would rather not think about death, certainly not the death of those we love, and most certainly not our own. But we do know that for each of us, our time will come to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We know this to be inevitably true, whether we think about it or not. Albert was well aware that his journey through the shadow of death was not only inevitable, but it was near. And as Albert faced that journey, he could say with David of Psalm 23, "I fear no evil, for you are with me." There are many roads in life we would rather not walk, but we have no choice but to walk them. It might be the journey of getting a cancer diagnosis, or it might be the road you walk after losing a loved one. There are many difficult roads to walk, but there is one thing that makes a significant difference, And that is simply walking that road with someone who has been there before. Walking difficult roads alone can be scary, but having someone at our side who has been there before and knows the way means we can say with confidence, "I fear no evil, for you are with me." Albert chose to walk through the valley of the shadow of death with someone at his side. And yes, there were many family and close friends who were faithfully at Albert's side as he faced this journey. But more than anyone else, the Good Shepherd walked with Albert through the valley. When we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, there is no person on this earth who can walk with us, having been there before. It is a one-way journey, and those who have walked it cannot come back to walk with us. The only one who has been through the valley of the shadow of death and come out the other side is Jesus. And so we do what Albert did. We take his hand in ours, and we ask the Good Shepherd to lead us on this journey. It was 8 days ago today that Albert passed, and 8 days from now, we will be celebrating Easter Sunday. Easter is about celebrating the fact that Jesus walked through the valley of the shadow of death, that he faced a death as complete as Albert's. And yet, 3 days later, he rose from the grave, defeating death in the process. Up until that first Easter Sunday, death was undefeated. It had never lost even once. But death was dealt a fatal blow when Jesus rose from the grave and said, "Death has no hold on me." Jesus won a victory over death that first Easter Sunday, and he shares that victory now with anyone who will give their life to him. This is what Albert had done, and this is what Albert would have wanted each person here today to know. And this is why Albert could walk through the valley of the shadow of death without fear. Because Jesus, who had conquered death, walked with him. The valley of the shadow of death is not so scary with the Good Shepherd by your side. He says, "I've been there before, and I know the way through, and eternity with the Father is waiting on the other side." And this is where Psalm 23 takes us in its final verses. "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And so this is Albert's reward. The Lord has prepared a banquet for him, and he will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Albert no longer struggles for breath. He no longer struggles with weakness of body, of mind, of faith. He now lives in God's house, not because he was a good guy, though he was, but because he trusted himself to the Good Shepherd, to Jesus as his Lord and Savior. This is why he could say his bags were packed, and to say it without any fear, but with eager expectation of seeing Mary, of seeing many others who had gone on before him, but ultimately of seeing Jesus. And so today, the Good Shepherd who walks with Albert promises to walk with us as well. Thankfully, the Shepherd can be in both places at the same time. We can no longer be with Albert, and this will hit us hard on days like today, on birthdays, on holidays, on Father's Day. We will miss him and long to be with him. And in those moments, I pray we will be reminded that the Good Shepherd has two hands. With one, he holds Albert on the streets of heaven. And with the other, he holds us in our grief and leads us gently to green pastures and quiet waters. He is the Good Shepherd. Let us trust ourselves to him today. Let us pray. God, our Father and Great Shepherd, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, and for his victory over death on the cross. We thank you that death is not the final word. We thank you for Easter, for forgiveness of sins and for the gift of eternal life. We thank you that you have offered this gift to Albert and that you offer it to us. We ask now that you would be the good shepherd to each of us who all need you in different ways. Would you walk with us and guide us and lead us as we go from here on our separate journeys? May all our paths lead back to you. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Stop.